Good morning, my brothers and sisters. I'd like to welcome you all to worship here on this beautiful snowy Sunday morning at First United Methodist Church in Los Alamos. Special welcome to our guests this morning, and for those who are worshiping with us online, which I'm assuming is a larger audience than what we normally see, thank you for welcoming us into your home wherever you're gathered this morning. I'm Reverend John Nash. I'm joined in worship leadership this morning. Christine is our lay reader. Yelena is on piano. Valerie and the bells will be leading us in our hymns. In the sound booth, we have Don, Linda, Abigail, and Lynn, and Kenneth and Ann are our ushers. So thank you to them for their worship leadership this morning. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, said, "Whoever you are, and whatever faith you were born, whatever creed you confess, if you have come here to find God, you are welcome here, and we are indeed glad that you are with us." We begin a new worship series this morning entitled Toy Box Leadership, looking at what we can learn about leadership in life from the classic toys that we grew up with. And so we hope that you have come with the expectation that we will encounter the risen Christ. The Holy Spirit will be moving and working amongst us here this morning, that we'll be transformed by gathering together as the body of Christ. I'm going to invite you to stand as you are comfortable. Remain seated if that is more comfortable, as Christine leads us in our call to worship and opening prayer.
God has adopted us as beloved heirs of the promise. Children of God. We are water washed and spirit filled. We are dead to sin and alive in Christ. May we set our hearts on righteousness, and may our hearts be set on a life of peace and forgiveness. Together, let us pray. O God of eternal redemption, just as the Spirit moved across the waters at the beginning of creation, so too does that same Spirit move across the waters of baptism, making us a new creation. May we not only hear the words you spoke to Jesus, claiming him as blessed and beloved, but claim them as our own. Baptized children, we are reconciled with you and empowered by the Spirit to be your witnesses and ambassadors in the world. May we never forget this reality in our lives. We pray these things through the Spirit and in the baptized name of Christ. Amen. I invite you to remain standing as you are, as we sing of the hope we find in our God, eternal through the ages.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith before God and one another. God is the eternal rock, the Alpha and the Omega. From the year's beginning to its end, God is faithful. In each day, God is present. In each action, God comes close. Through all eternity, God is trustworthy. Yesterday, today, and forever. Sustaining, enlivening, making all things new. God is the eternal rock. Amen. Together, let us pray our prayer for illumination. God of eternal wisdom, open our hearts, minds, and souls to hear your word and to discern its application in our lives. Amen. Our first reading comes from the Acts of the Apostles. Paul has been traveling in his journeys, meeting Priscilla and Aquila, who become Paul's traveling companions, before he returns to Jerusalem and then goes to Antioch. But Priscilla and Aquila encounter Apollos in Ephesus, who is spreading a gospel, but only knows the gospel of John. And so they take him aside and teach him the full gospel. Where Apollos travels on to proclaim this new message, while Paul comes to Ephesus after Apollo leaves. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the inland regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came down upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Although, altogether, there were about 12 of them. Our second reading is the story of Jesus' baptism, this year from the Gospel of Mark. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way." The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole of Judea countryside and all of the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth to Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
If you have celebrations, concerns, or hopes to lift up to God this morning, you are invited to come forward and light a candle. You may also fill out a prayer card to be lifted up in prayer during worship. For those worshiping online, you are also invited to light a candle where you are and to put your prayer requests in the comment section or submit them through the Church Center app as we continue worshiping through song.
So if you've not already been using your scripture insert, I invite you to take that out. On the back is a place to write things to remember from today's service. So as I said in the introduction, today we begin a new worship series that will take us through to Lent, which will begin in the middle of February this year, looking at what classic toys can teach us about leadership and life. I really wasn't sure what I was going to do for this worship series as we're planning in the fall, and so I talked to Philip about, is there something that we should be talking to for the church, things that would help our faith developments, and he said we might look at our goals that we had set begin this year and see if there was something there. And in my list of potential worship series that I keep as reference, I wrote down a long time ago from a book I read entitled Toy Box Leadership. And to let you know how long ago I read this book, in the introduction they talk about what's happening at Blockbuster Video and the decisions they're going to have to make in the very immediate future that will determine whether they survive or not, and we know how that turned out. But I'm indebted to that book and its authors Ron Hunter and Michael Waddell for their inspiration. And with that, today we begin with one of those staples of childhood play, Play-Doh, which was actually inducted into the inaugural class of the National Toy Hall of Fame. And if you're ever in Rochester, New York, the museum there of toys is fantastic. You should go visit. And Carol has made Play-Doh for everybody who's in the sanctuary today to take home with you as well. Now, I have to say, of all the toys we will look at, Play-Doh is actually one of my least favorites, at least as an adult. Because when our children get Play-Doh as a gift, which they invariably do, I sort of bow my head and think, oh, great, thanks. Because Play-Doh is great to play with. I remember playing with it as a child, but as an adult, right, when our kids play with it, they leave those little pieces all over. They get dried out, and for weeks afterwards, seemingly, I'm still finding little dried out pieces of Play-Doh all around the house. But I guess then it's sort of ironic that this is where we begin this series, and looking about Play-Doh and baptism and leadership, all sort of linked together, and I bet none of you ever thought that you would hear a message about that. Play-Doh came about for Christmas 1954 when Kay Zufall, who ran a nursery school, discovered that you could take the substance that was used to clean wallpaper and you could form it into shapes and let it dry out and then let the children decorate it and give it as presents to parents, which the parents raved about. And so she told her brother-in-law, who happened to own a wallpaper cleaning company, that this substance that he was using makes a great toy. And thus, Play-Doh was born. After the detergents were removed from it, a new formula was come up with. And I will note that the substance as a wallpaper cleaner had existed for 20 years before someone decided this could be a toy. No one had looked at it that way before that point. Today, more than 100 million cans of Play-Doh are sold in more than 60 different colors. And the distinctive smell that Play-Doh has was actually bottled into a perfume for its 50th anniversary. But there are several key pieces to know about Play-Doh that are examples for us to learn from. The first is that Play-Doh depends upon its malleability or moldability to be useful. Right? If you leave it outside of the can, which my children like to do, it becomes dried and usually gets thrown away. That's what I spend my time doing, is cleaning up after them. Even if it's been molded into different shapes and dried out, eventually it probably makes its way to the trash can. And I think that same metaphor can be used for us. That we too have to remain open to change. And of seeing the world in new and different ways, especially to being shaped by the movement of the Spirit. That when we get locked into shapes and no longer are able to be affected or changed or modified or shaped into something else, when we block off all new ideas, say that can't happen, I don't want to participate in that, then we become like that dried Play-Doh. And invariably, it not only gets us into trouble, but it also becomes problematic for other people, because then rather being a liability, we now become an asset. We become a liability of being the agents that are trying to stop any new change that comes along. And so again, at the very least, that hardness of heart or mind or spirit or soul or whatever it might be will keep us from being able to experience the movements of the Spirit, at the very least, in our lives. And we have to remain pliable to do new things. And I did learn this week that there are ways to get dried Play-Doh to be malleable again, right, to make it like it's supposed to be. And so it's, again, a reminder for us that even old dogs can learn new tricks. And yet that same pliability and ability to be shaped are also where we need to be careful and where the idea of baptism comes into play. As we celebrate the baptism of the Lord today, we'll remember our own baptismal vows in a few moments. Because for us as Christians, baptism is foundational and it is formational. No one is born a Christian. Becoming a Christian is not about believing the right thing or saying the right prayer. The tradition in the church is that we become Christians through the waters of baptism. That this baptism is our initiation rite into the church. And it is this the baptism that forms us as Christians as well. It is what makes us a new creation in Christ. It pushes us off who we used to be, right? Our old selves, we die to our old selves and we're reborn in Christ. We take on a new shape. We are a new creation. And so same thing is true with baptism, with Play-Doh, right? I have a little dinosaur mold here. If I put Play-Doh into this mold, what's going to come out of it? A dinosaur, right? That's what's molding this Play-Doh is that shape. And if I want a dog, can I get a dog out of this? No, but if I take the Play-Doh shape of a dinosaur and I put it into a dog mold and close it up, guess what I'm going to get? A dog, right? What is around us is what forms us and shapes us. Just like the old saying that you are what you eat, so too do you become who you associate with. So most of you know that my wife, Linda, is an addict. She'll celebrate 30 years clean and sober this year. But one of the things for people who are seeking to become clean or sober, right, one of the things they have to do is stop associating with those that they had used with before. Because if they keep associating with all the friends and going to the same places and doing the same things, are they going to stay clean and sober? No. In order to stay clean and sober, they have to create a new life, right? They have to start associating with new people and doing new things, going to new places. The people around us, the things around us, the thoughts around us mold us. And so if you're going to surround yourself or you're around unethical people, guess what you're more than likely to do? Unethical things, right? Some of you probably saw a story. The Albuquerque Police Department arrested 11 people at the Target in Paseo in Albuquerque as part of a theft ring. 11 people in one store. Now, do you think when all 11 people started at that store that they were thieves? No, probably not any of them actually were. But being around this group of people who were willing to bend the rules and the laws got bigger and bigger numbers of people involved, right? Because they said, I like these people. I don't think that they're doing bad. They're not bad people, so this must be an okay thing to do. You are formed by the people and ideas and thoughts that you surround yourself with. And so as we think about New Year's resolutions, if anybody still has them 7 days into the month, right? If you want to start working out or losing weight or stop smoking or reading more, whatever it might be, what you need to do is actually begin associating and being friends with people who are doing those things. And if you want to do the opposite, if you want to break those resolutions, be around people who are smoking and gaining weight and not working out, we're molded and shaped by the things, the thoughts, and the people that surround us. And so similarly, if you surround yourself with hate, with violence, with demeaning language, with racism, with xenophobia, with misogyny, with retaliation, with bullying, with fear, with harassment, with alarm, all those things that surround us every day in our culture, especially on social media, and if you follow leaders who promote and do those things, you will become those things. You will think those things. You will do those things. We are influenced. We take the shape and the form of the people and the ideas and the thoughts that we surround ourselves with. So if instead you want to be an agent of love, you have to surround yourself with people who are loving. And if you want to be more forgiving, you have to surround your people who live in forgiveness. And if you want to live in peace, you have to surround yourself with peacemakers. If you want to be humble, you have to surround yourself with people who know humility. If you want baptism to mold you, then you have to surround yourself with people for whom baptism is foundational and formational. Right? And being a Christian doesn't mean you're going to automatically do those second sets. I think plenty of us can know people who claim that they are Christians who hate and fear and demonize, right? And plenty of people who are not Christians who love and forgive and live in humility. For us as Christians, though, we need to make sure that our baptism is that mold that forms who we are with the Play-Doh of our lives, to be the people that God has called us to be. And so let me close with one last thought. As I said, Play-Doh now comes in 60 different colors. But is there any difference in the Play-Doh between white and blue and green and red or any of the others, other than the color it is? No. The formula is exactly the same, right? They just add coloring to it. The Play-Doh is exactly the same no matter what color you have. And if you can create something all in one color, right? But if you try to create a rainbow all in green or all in white, is it going to be all that satisfactory? Not really, right? You need those other colors to make it something more. Now, there are people who want to complain then, because one of the problems you have with Play-Doh is what happens when you mix up the colors. Can you ever get them separated again? No, they sort of stick together. And again, there's people who want to complain about that and say it's one of the problems with Play-Doh, that it just dilutes the Play-Doh, maybe it poisons it, but that's sort of exactly the point of Play-Doh too. Because last week, Lizzie and I were talking about Play-Doh, and so she asked me to get the Play-Doh off her shelf, and I pulled this out, and I opened up the first can, and this is what it looked like, even the lid says blue. And I opened up the red can, and this is what it looked like, right? All of them look like this because she'd molded them all together. And I said, well, I didn't expect that. And she said, that's what it's supposed to look like, Dad. That's when it's the most fun. Out of the mouths of babes. Because Paul tells us that in baptism, that in Christ, there is no longer slave or free, Greek or Jew, male and female, for we are all one in Christ Jesus. In the waters of baptism, we are many members, but one body in Christ who is all and is in all. Baptism is foundational for us as Christians. It is the formational act of becoming a Christian. It is in the waters of baptism that we die to our old selves and are reborn, that we are forgiven our sin and reconciled with God, that we are adopted by God and made heirs of the promise. It is in the water of baptism that we receive the Holy Spirit, that we become one in the body of Christ, the church, and made one with each other. For there is only one Spirit, and one body, and one Lord, and one faith, and one baptism. And so in our baptisms, may we be made like Play-Doh, to be reformed and molded into the image of Christ, to be the people that God has called us to be shaped into Christ for the world. I pray that it will be so, my brothers and sisters. Amen. Now I invite you to stand as you are comfortable, and we're going to reaffirm our baptismal vows this morning. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If you do, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? And according to the grace given to you, we remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world. If you will, say, I will. And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. And after the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. And their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. And we respond, sing to the Lord all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare Christ's work to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. And you may be seated, and I'm going to invite Royce Taylor to come forward, who is going to take the membership vows for this congregation. He has a really easy one because he is transferring his membership from another United Methodist church. So you can stand right there, Royce. No, you can come forward. I don't bite, but I want you to stand right in front of me. So Royce, as a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If you will, say, I will. Amen. Members of the household of God, I commend this person to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love. We congregate. Thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now may the God of all grace, who has called to us eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power and Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. So let us welcome the newest member of our congregation, Royce. Your turn. And actually, I have a membership certificate for you as well. And I invite you to stand again as you are comfortable. Remain seated if that's more comfortable for our hymn of response, Remembering God's Participation in Our Baptism. And you may be seated. Before we lift up our celebrations and concerns to God, we'd like to lift up some of the work of the church in your worship guide. You'll find a list of activities, things that are coming up. A couple we'd like to highlight first is on behalf of the staff. Thank you for all your gifts and offerings and words of encouragement in this Christmas season. Past Christmas season, it was greatly appreciated. The giving statements for last year are available, so if you need those for tax purposes for those in the sanctuary, they're here available as you're leaving. They'll be here next two Sundays. If you want those who worship with us online, if you want to receive it, just contact us and we'll mail them to you. Otherwise, we'll mail them around the 16th or so. Those will go out, so you can pick them up or receive them in the mail. And our community food pantry provides foods for different people. We sort of see different needs as we transitioned out of fall into the winter months. And so in your a list available in the worship guide, there's a list of the foods that we're looking for that. You'll also find that in the newsletter. So thank you for all those who are supporting that ministry. One of our expectations that we'll be in prayer at least once a day. And so in your worship guide, you'll find a list of celebrations and concerns we're aware of earlier this week. And in your scripture insert, you'll find a list of the families of the church to be in prayer for. That's one of our membership vows, is to pray for one another. We just reaffirmed those as well. But a couple others to highlight or add to your list. And you'll find that in the back of the scripture insert is a place to add for prayers. First, as we were informed that Charmaine Weber passed away on Tuesday of this week. Service plans have not been made. They're still working amongst that family. Prayers for Howard Granzo, who had a heart attack. Was at St. Vincent's in Santa Fe. He's scheduled to have a catheterization done on Monday. So prayers for Howard and Kim. And then prayers for Carol Pyburn, who will be moving into an assisted living facility in Santa Fe this next week, which she hopes is temporary, but we don't know yet. So add those to your prayer list for this week as well. So as we go to God with our prayers, we'll lift up our petition, and I will say, give us strength, O Lord, and we reply, and bless us with peace. O glorious God, maker of heaven and earth, hear us as we pray. We pray for the world that you have made. Move again over these troubled waters, steeped in chemicals and stained with blood, where carelessness and violence bring chaos. Restore order and goodness and life. Give us strength, O Lord, and bless us with peace. We pray for the church you have redeemed. Renew in us the gifts of your Spirit and the call to Christian discipleship. Where history and heresy have divided us, make us one in the baptism we share. Give us strength, O Lord, and bless us with peace. We pray for all the peoples you have created. Give to the leaders of all nations the wisdom to know what is good. Where people are poor and hungry, provide justice and daily bread. Give us strength, O Lord, and bless us with peace. We pray for loved ones you have given us. Bless our families, friends, and neighbors. Keep them safe from trouble and danger. Where there is sorrow, sickness, or suffering, send your Spirit of comfort and healing. Give us strength, O Lord, and bless us with peace. We pray all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus, whose voice is our strength and our salvation, whose breath is the Spirit of peace, and all the church says, amen. So thank you to all of you and everyone who helped support our Christmas mission projects for our mitten tree. We collected 55 hats, 10 sets of mittens, and 3 scarves. Those will be sent to the Four Corners Ministry in Farmington for their homeless shelter. And our Christmas Eve offering, which we donate to the Rio Reba Dolly Parton Imagination Library, collected just a little over $1,000, which is enough to fund 30 children in Rio Arriba County receiving a book every single month from that important ministry. So thank you so much for supporting those seeking out to make a difference in people's lives. So one of our membership vows is that we will support this church financially. What you say is giving a portion of our income or with a tithe or 10% as the goal. There are several ways you can give for those in the sanctuary. In a few moments, we'll pass around the offering plates. You can place your offering into the plate. If you've given electronically, you'll find a green card in the pew pocket. You can place that into the plate representing your gift. If you'd like to give electronically, you'll find a QR code on the green card. You can scan that. It'll take you to our website, firstinyourheart.org. You can also click on Secure Giving there, or through the Church Center app, follow those steps. Text the dollar amount you'd like to give to 84321 or mail in your checks to the church. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for making a difference. We are indeed God's love in action. If the ushers would please come forward to receive this morning's offering.
The child that was born there has come to set us free. And the Lord of Lords,
go.
And as part of the communion liturgy for this morning, we'll be using hymn number 383, This is the Day of New Beginnings. If you'd like to see the music, verses will be on the screen. Christ invites to his table all who are ready to move beyond the limitations of the past, all who are eager to move into the new thing that God is doing in our midst, all who are willing to let go of the pain that's gone.
And so this is not yet, I'm sorry.
This is a day of new beginnings, time to remember and move on, time to believe what love is bringing, laying to rest the pain that's gone. And
so this is an open invitation to come and receive the bread that will sustain us as we embark on this new call. All are invited to receive the sweetness of the cup as a sign of God's promise of abundant possibilities. All are invited to this meal, for all are forgiven their past regrets and invited into God's grace-filled future.
Praise to the living God. And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts in this new day.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And as we give thanks, I invite you, as you are called, to extend your hands in front of you as a sign of giving.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, creator and renewer of all life. Time and again, you seek us out, breathing again the breath of life into the deflated places in our lives.
Put up the hymn.
In faith we gather round the table to taste and share what love can do. This is the day of new beginnings. Our God is making all things new.
And so we come to your table again to praise you and taste yet again what your steadfast love can do. And so this is an open invitation to come and receive the bread that will sustain us as we embark on this new call. All are invited to receive the sweetness of the cup as a sign.
Sorry.
That's why I was. We just sang this one.
No, we sang this one. So you are down here. Sorry. There you go. Right there.
That's what I...
That's all me. Sorry.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. He healed the sick and fed the hungry and ate with those others considered unworthy. Through him, faith and hope were born again for so many.
For by the life and death of Jesus, God's mighty Spirit now has been, can make for us a world of difference as faith and hope are born again.
As we give, we also receive, and so I invite you to pull your hands into your chest as a sign of receiving, remembering that on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus gathered with disciples in the upper room, and he took a piece of bread, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took a cup, and he gave thanks to God, And he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so, as we remember these words and acts of Jesus, we offer our own lives, leaving behind what we do not need, seeking new paths full of risen life in you. As followers of Christ, we proclaim and live out this holy mystery.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Then let us with the Spirit's daring step from the past and leave behind our disappointment, guilt, and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find.
And one of the oldest ways of being in prayer was not to bow your head and clasp your hands, but instead to lift your arms and face up to God. So I invite you to do that as we call for God to pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. And on these gifts of bread and the vine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, breaking ourselves open to your future. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Christ is alive and goes before us to show and share what love can do. This is a day of new beginnings. Our God is making all things new.
I invite you, as you are comfortable, to reach out your hands to others, or to hold hands as you are comfortable, as a sign of blessing, as together with the confidence of children of God, we say the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. You may be seated.
And the rickets, too. baptism and be thankful. Grace, remember your baptism and be thankful. My pleasure. Pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit, united in the body of Christ to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior, and all the church says, Amen.
Thank you.
So another one of our expectations is we'll be reading the Bible daily. So in your scripture inserts, our recommended scripture readings for each day of the week. Find a prayer for the week to help you do your daily prayer, and scripture readings and questions to help you prepare for next Sunday. It's a contemporary service. We'll move on to what Slinky Dog can teach us about leadership and life. And I'm told there's about a quarter inch outside, so if you need assistance getting to your vehicle, we have put out desalting, but it's still a little slippery. So if you need help getting out to your vehicle from the sanctuary, please let Philip or someone know. We will help get you out to your car and drive home. Be safe on your drive home.
Hear these words from Paul's letter to the Ephesians about what unites us in the faith. Paul writes, "I, therefore, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all."
So go forth united in faith to be ambassadors of the good news. And may the love of the Father and the strength of the Son and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.
Now go be the church.